Hey church, it's a privilege to be able to spend this week with you as we open God's Word, looking at Ephesians chapter 3, considering the mystery that has been revealed. I hope last week you were able to join us in our live stream at 9:30 and or 11, celebrating some baptisms in our church, celebrating some testimonies in our church of how God has drawn people in our community to Himself and drawn people into our community. It was a great celebration where we were able to just refix our eyes on this reality that we are not a church that's theoretically committed to the gospel or believes in a theoretical gospel, but that we are genuinely committed to the gospel that still saves people, transform them from death, as Ephesians 2 verse 1 would say, to life, as Ephesians 2 verse 4 would say, because of the God who's rich in mercy, making us alive in Christ. That we believe in that message today as much as we did when we started our church, and that we are committed to making that message known. Just want to share with you real quick some exciting news. Last week we had our largest Giving Sunday to date. That we are a church that's 3 years old, and our church showed up in a really significant way, giving generously to the mission and the work that God has entrusted to our church. Now this was preceded by September, which I was excited to share with you as well, September being the largest giving month in our church's history. And I just want you to know that my heart, my soul has been blessed by your generosity, that I have been inspired and spurred on towards the good works that God has called not only me to do, but us to do collectively together as we've linked arms in the mission and the work that God's entrusting to our church. And I just can't tell you how excited I am about partnering with you in the work that God wants to do through us together. And we have some exciting things that are happening in our church life this fall with our student ministry, with our women's life ministry, and their first Saturday event this past week. Each week, we just are committed to doing what we can to love one another well and to love our community well. And I want you to know that we love you, that we're praying for you each week. That many of us, myself included, have found ourselves at times incredibly discouraged and feeling defeated by the current circumstances and season that we find ourselves in. And I want you to know that you're not alone, that you can reach out to me, that you can reach out to your life group leader, that you can reach out to someone in our church, and that we will care for you, that we will pray for you, and that we will walk alongside you well. Just this last week, as I was praying with Larry regarding a procedure that he was stepping into, we were reminded together as we encouraged one another that we are oftentimes pressed, but we do not have to be crushed. That we are oftentimes perplexed, but we do not have to despair. That we are oftentimes confronted with persecution, but that God has not abandoned us. And that we are oftentimes struck down, but we do not have to be destroyed. When we build our lives on the sure foundation of Jesus, that we can withstand even the most difficult seasons in life. And if you're finding that you are discouraged, if you're finding that you're just struggling getting out of kind of a mental space that seems to be spiraling, don't walk through that alone, but reach out to me. My cell number is 208-695-0260. My email is wforrest with two R's, F-O-R-R-E-S-T at summitlifeseattle.com. Hopefully if you're tied into a life group, you have the contact information of one of your life group leaders. But we believe in doing life together. And a part of that is walking with each other through seasons of triumph, which we are celebrating some things in our life, but also through seasons of trial. And we know that while we celebrate in one breath, that many of us on the other breath are struggling, walking through significant trials. And so we're with you. We're praying with you. I'm praying for you this week as we turn to God's Word, looking at Ephesians chapter 3, asking God to just encourage your spirit with the word of truth and life. So let's pray together. We're going to jump into the first 13 verses of Ephesians chapter 3. Let's pray. Father, we are thankful for your grace in our life. Lord, we are thankful that you are with us in all seasons. Father, we are thankful for your faithfulness to our church family. God, it is nothing short of your kindness evidenced in our church life that we would be able to be in a building that we can use, that we'd be able to be pressing forward in mission and ministry. And God, I pray that you would use every resource ever entrusted to our church to see your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that we would be a people that seek the welfare of our city as sojourners moving through this land, knowing that our residence fully and completely and our citizenship fully and completely is found in heaven. Lord, use this study in our lives this morning to shape us, to inspire us, and to spur us on towards the work that you've called us to. We love you, Lord, and we ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, as you work your way to Ephesians chapter 3, you're going to find that the title over this section in most Bibles is the mystery of the gospel revealed. The word that Paul would use in verse 6 of chapter 3, the Greek word being mysterion, literally means something that was once disclosed, that you just didn't know what was going on behind the scenes, that it was concealed for those who had preceded the life, death, resurrection of Jesus, that there was a mystery, much like you and I find ourselves captivated by the mystery of movies. We will walk through the pop plot line, and as that plot line develops, the story becomes more fully disclosed, and it's once we see the end of the story that we begin to put the dots together. As the timeline unfolds, we begin to see that which was once concealed now being fully revealed. I was, as a kid, just captivated by the Scooby-Doo TV shows and movies, that this idea that there was a mystery always unfolding in Scooby-Doo and his friends' lives, and that their job was to understand the mystery. And you would always see this mystery as the story and plot line unfolded. You would see the mystery revealed, that there was always someone behind the scenes pulling the strings to accomplish a work. And Paul, in this text, uses a word that would point to this idea that there was a time where that which we understand in Ephesians chapter 3, that it was concealed, that it was foreshadowed, that it was pointed to, but it was not fully revealed. Oftentimes people will say the Old Testament, you see the promises concealed, in the New Testament, you see them fully revealed as the Word incarnate, Jesus, and the Word inspired, that which we're studying this morning, is what reveals the mystery that God has been unfolding since the beginning of time. This mystery is revealed primarily, as Paul would use the word mystery throughout a number of his different letters to the churches in the first century. This word mystery is primarily attached to two different mysteries. One, the mystery of the gospel revealed through the individual, as we talked about 2 weeks ago, as God's immeasurable grace has been displayed through their personal testimony. That it is a mystery that's been revealed, that you can, without going to a high priest, without going to a temple, that you can approach God's throne with confidence as a priesthood of the believer, as Peter would write in his epistle, as a priesthood of the believer, that through the blood of Jesus, that you can approach God's throne with confidence. That's a part of the mystery that has been revealed, this idea that you who were once separated have been drawn near to a God through the finished and completed work of Jesus, not by your own achievement, but by the completed achievement and work of Christ on the cross. This week we're going to see this second part of that mystery revealed, which is the mystery of the gospel being revealed not just through the individual, but through the church, as the immeasurable grace of God is displayed in the gathering of the saints. So it's not just a mystery revealed that leads to further isolation, autonomy, and individuality, but that in your individuality, you have a place within a larger community. And in that larger community, as the saints assemble, as they gather and are the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, the people, not the building, as they come together, that the mystery is being revealed, not just to the world around us, but being revealed, as the text would say, to the heavenlies, that God's manifold wisdoms displayed through the churches were not only drawn near to him, but as God would break down the walls that would cause us to be isolated from one another and invites us into a community together. The history of the church, real quickly, and this is important as it's going to dive into Ephesians chapter 3, that the history of the church began in Jerusalem, primarily among the Jewish community, that Jesus' disciples were all Jewish, and the work of the gospel was predominantly through Jesus expanded to the Jewish community. And we see that testimony of Jesus beginning in Jerusalem regarding his resurrection. Didn't go to surrounding regions, but it began in Jerusalem, in the central hub for the Jewish community. All historians would affirm the fact that the testimony of the resurrection of Jesus began in Jerusalem, where Jesus was crucified. Now, as the gospel began to take root in Jerusalem, as Acts would unfold the story of the early church, we see in Acts chapter 11 that the gospel had made its way to Antioch, and that there were these Gentiles who had been indwelled by the Holy Spirit, and the gospel was being advanced through them. And so the early church sends Barnabas, the son of encouragement, down there to see what it is that's going on, to affirm the testimony that the gospel has taken root among the Gentiles. And then two chapters later, Acts chapter 13, Paul and Barnabas would be set apart for the ministry of making known the gospel among the Gentiles. And the hub of ministry in the first century church would eventually pivot from Jerusalem, being a predominantly Jewish community, to Antioch, where the gospel would spread to the nations, literally to the nations. And this is a remarkable history, because historically the ethnic groups were divided from one another, and yet through the gospel, the work of Christ, this invitation to be a part of the family of God was extended not only to the Jew, but also to the Gentile. That's why Paul, multiple times throughout his letters to the early church, would say it's a gospel that is the salvation, Romans 1:16, for the Jew and for the Gentile. And as we step into Ephesians chapter 3, I think it's important for us to note, just on the front end, that what we read in Ephesians chapter 3 is a church unified around the mission and the message of God. And yet, if we were just to look at the common experience of humanity across our world, particularly today, right? So this is the general humanity. We would see that unity is not the descriptor that we oftentimes find within our world today. And I think we could boil this down. The division that we experience in our lives today, in our marriage, in our family, in our community, in our nation, in our world, and even sometimes within the church, the division we experience in our lives is rooted in competing interests and competing values. You could use the synonym when you're saying competing interests, competing purposes or interests, and competing values. And the subtle assault, I believe, that comes against our faith in our life isn't an all-out eradication of God, but rather an enthronement of self as the greatest authority. Let me say that again. I do not think the assault on your faith is an all-out eradication of God in your life, that God would be excluded from all things, but rather a subtle shift from God being the authority, the one who would define your values, the one who would define your purposes, a subtle shift from him being the authority and an enthronement of self. In fact, Mark Sayers, in his book, The Disappearing Church, he would write, "In the Western mind, God has increasingly been relegated to the role of servant and massager of the personal will." that in the Western world, in the post-Christian era, in post-modernism, that even that there would be those who were spiritualists, that don't have an issue with God, but if there's a God, his purpose is not to be Lord, but his purpose is to be servant or a massager of the personal will. What we experience in the church today is a demonstration of the power of God. It is altogether different from what we see play out in the world. In fact, if we were to go back to Ephesians chapter 2 that we didn't have time to fully unpack last week, we would see three different pictures that Paul would give regarding the local church. We would see that they are stones. The idea of stones, you're being brought together to build the temple in which God would dwell as people. Now, if you're familiar with the way that the temple was built, the stones would be chiseled, which ties into this idea that we're God's workmanship. We're being shaped to be a part of a larger work, larger body. The second picture we see in chapter 2 of the church is family, that we've been adopted into the family of God. And then finally, that we are citizens. We're no longer strangers, but we're citizens, part of the heavenly kingdom. This is summed up in this phrase that Paul would use in chapter 2, that we are, in verse 14, that we the two flesh have become one. The Jew and the Gentile who were once separated through Christ have become one. This is altogether different from what we see play out in the world today. What we experience in the church, the two flesh becoming one, is a display of the gospel in the assembly, in the gathering of the saints. As we step into chapter 3, we're going to see that this display of God's glory is accomplished through unlikely people. The main point this week is God uses unlikely people to reveal his glory. Let's pick up in verse 1 of chapter 3, working through the first 13 verses. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ, prisoner for Christ, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of the grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which has not been known to me, been made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to the holy apostles and the prophets by the Spirit. The mystery is that, okay, so he's going to unpack the mystery, verse 6. The mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for the ages in God who created all things. Verse 10, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be known to the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purposes that he has realized in Christ Jesus, our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you, do not lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory. God uses unlikely people to reveal his glory. The first unlikely messenger is Paul. Paul in verse 1 describes himself as a prisoner for Christ, as we see in verse 2 that it's because of the stewardship of God's grace that was entrusted to him. Now, we just need to understand Paul and the unlikely messenger that he would be for the Gentiles to hear the gospel, the good news of Jesus that would save them from their sin and invite them into being heirs of God, co-heirs with Christ. If we flipped back to Acts chapter 8, we would see that Paul was a part of the killing of Stephen, the first martyr for the Christian faith. If we looked at chapter 8, verse 1 of the book of Acts, we would see this phrase, Paul approved of Stephen's execution. that Paul was not an innocent bystander. He was not just a witness on the side observing what was going on as Stephen's life was literally being taken from him. We're not talking figurative killing, that there was a literal martyring of Stephen, and Paul was there, and it was his approval that led to the death of Stephen, that Paul stood in stark contrast. He stood against. He was not apathetic towards the Christian movement. He was an antagonist towards the Christian movement. He stood against the work of God that was being accomplished through the disciples, so much so that he was the one that was giving approval for those who would name the name of Jesus as Lord and Savior. He was giving the approval for them to be killed for their faith. We move forward to chapter 9, verse 1. We see that Paul, formerly known as Saul, is going to Damascus. And the text says a full chapter later that he's still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. That Paul stood against the gospel movement. That everything about Paul's life was in stark contrast to the work that God was doing through the church. And yet we see in chapter 9, as Paul made his way to Damascus, he would meet the resurrected Savior, and he would go from breathing murderous threats against the church to being one who would be a catalyst for the movement of the local church. Here he says that he had been given the stewardship of God's grace, making known to the Gentiles the mystery of God's will. That this unlikely person who stood against everything that the church would stand for would become the catalyst to make the gospel known among the Gentiles. What made Paul an unlikely means to reveal God's glory? That he wanted to stop the gospel, not serve as a catalyst for it. That if we read the story of Acts, that Paul had no desire to be a part of seeing this movement advanced. Rather, he wanted to see this movement stop. The key truth that I think we need to understand as we look at Paul's life as the one who had been given the stewardship of God's grace, making known the mystery of the revelation to the Gentile people. We have to understand that we are prone to limit the means through which God's glory can be revealed when our focus is on the means rather than the God who's sovereign over that means. That we can limit what we believe God to do when we look at the means around us as the catalyst for the glory of God rather than the God who's sovereign over those means as the one who can use any circumstances to advance his work, who use any circumstances for the good of those who love him and who are called according to his purposes. Just let me share a real life example just happening in this moment for us. The current climate of our world would say that the gospel can't be advanced, the church can't be unified, that the work of God is going to have to be put on hold because everything else in the world has been put on hold. And if it's not impossible, it's certainly super difficult to see the work of God advance in this current climate that we live in. And yet, consider for a moment a few things that have happened of late in our church life. Last week we had 5 baptisms. The week before we had 30 church leaders in our building encouraged to press on in the work that God's called them to, scattered throughout Puget Sound. We had the largest giving month in September to date in 3 years of our church life, followed by the largest giving week. We've had multiple conversations right in front of this building, even some that have come into this building and had gospel conversations in this building. We've had the fact that the building is done and that we are able to use the building is a miracle in and of itself. That 20 months ago, when our small little church got together and said, we're going to take a step of faith and we're going to start reclaiming this space and reworking this space so that we can have a place to gather and worship someday. We would have never guessed 20 months ago how mission critical it would be to have a space that we could utilize. Again, a means towards a greater end. The means is the building. The greater end is God's glory being evidenced in and through our local church. And God's doing that. The work of God is going forward, even in a season where we would be met with opposition. We are prone to limit our belief in God's glory being revealed in our lives when the means becomes the catalyst for God's glory being revealed, rather than God who is sovereign over those means as the catalyst. The God who's able as the catalyst to see his glory advanced through our life. All of this work that God's done in our church over the course of the last 7 months has been in the middle of a global pandemic. God is able. God is able even when we are met with the most difficult circumstances. God is able to reveal his glory through unlikely messengers just like Paul. We move forward to the second unlikely messenger, not just the messenger to the Gentiles, but the messenger to the heavenlies. We see that in verse 8 that the mystery is this, that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, member of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. We fast forward to verse 10 and we see that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly places. That there is a second messenger that's revealing the glory of God, an unlikely messenger, and it's namely the church, made up of people from different backgrounds, ethnic backgrounds, made up of people from different socioeconomic backgrounds, made up of people from different generational backgrounds, different professional backgrounds. That the church is what displays the manifold wisdom of God, that as the saints assemble, that we see the magnitude of God's rich grace in the lives of the people who are unified. And the text in verse 6 would speak of three different things that happen as we come together, particularly through the Gentiles, that we in Christ are fellow heirs of God. That we're fellow heirs of God. What is an heir? It is to stand in the position which legally and rightly entitles us to succeed the inheritance that has been given. But the inheritance that we see in Scripture is not an earthly inheritance, not a worldly title or distinction, but rather it's an eternal treasure that God has entrusted to us, the heirs of God. It is an inheritance that's incorruptible, undefiled, and that does not fade away. It's laid up for us in heaven. It is the inheritance of eternal life in the kingdom of God. Hang with me for a minute as we continue to unpack what it means to be an heir of God. Because as we think through the person of Jesus, our souls are oftentimes lost in wonder as we reflect and imagine the exalted and glorified state of Christ. We know that Jesus has gone into heaven, that he's seated at the right hand of God the Father, that he has authority over the angels and over the authorities and over the powers, that all are subject beneath him. We see it in Philippians chapter 2. We see it in Colossians chapter 2. We see that Jesus has authority over all things. Now, God's glory is great, and it's revealed through his son Jesus. But hang with me for a minute. In John 17, verse 22, Jesus would say this, "The glory which God gave me, I have given them." Speaking of those who would come into this family of God, into the citizenship of heaven, into these stones that are being brought together as the temple of God. The glory which God gave to him, he's also extended to us. Romans 8, 15 through 17, the Spirit itself bears witness within our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. Thus, the inheritance to which the Gentiles are called is nothing less than to be co-partners with the Jews in the work of God and as children of God. That it's not based on their ethnicity, that it's not based on their background, but it's based on the work that God had accomplished on their behalf. They are heirs of God. The second descriptor of the mystery being revealed as the Gentiles are invited in. They are members of the same body. That we in Christ are members of the same body. That there's a remarkable union that happens within the church. But you cannot experience this union outside of the church, for Jesus is the means through which the union is accomplished. Corinthians would say that we, being many, are one body in Christ, and everyone members of one another, that we are all a part of the same body. Corinthians 10, verse 17 would say, we being many are one bread and we're one body. For from Christ all life proceeds and is diffused and infused together with several members. And Christ, is our connection not only to God, but to each other. Now, here's what this truth, being members of the same body, teaches us. It teaches us to be sympathetic towards one another. It teaches us to love one another. It teaches us to delight in each other, to not delight in the harming of one another, right? The hand doesn't delight in the injury of the foot. The tongue does. The tongue proclaims not the defects of the eye. That there is a protection, that there is a care, that there is a genuine union within the local churches as we're unified in Christ to one another. So the believers ought to be tender, compassionate in all of their communion, all of their fellowship with each other. That's why the gospel rule is to bear one another's burdens. It's why Scripture would teach to rejoice with those who rejoice and to mourn, to weep, to grieve with those who would grieve. And the warning in Galatians 5, verse 15 would say, but if you bite and devour one another, take heed lest you be consumed by one another. We are one body. And we know what happens when a body is working against itself. It self-destructs. When I was about 10 years old, 9, 10 years old, I had a disease that was called erythema multiforme. And my body thought that I had a disease, and so it was killing off my immune system. And I was sick as a dog. Sick as a dog. I thought, this is the end. I've lived a good full 10 years, 9 years, however old I was. I remember just laying on our couch days after days, and my parents had taken me to the doctor. They'd taken me to the doctor. They'd had people from the church to come over and pray over me for healing. And once they were able to diagnose that my body was killing itself, they were able to treat the disease. And all of a sudden, I became healthy. But a body that's fighting against itself, as Scripture would say in Galatians 5, verse 15, cannot stand. We're not called to devour one another. We're called to care for one another. We're called to be compassionate with one another. We're called to share one another's burdens. Why? Because we're members of the same body, Gentile and Jew. Paul goes on saying, you're partakers of the promise. This is an important part of what Paul's pointing out. And as he's speaking of this mystery being revealed through the assembly of the local church, the promises that God gave to the Jews in the Old Testament, particularly that he would bless them, that he would make a covenant with them, and foreshadowed the covenant of the work that Jesus would do on the cross for them, that they are grafted in. We see in Galatians 3:13 that Christ has redeemed us from the curse of law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangs on the tree. That the blessing of Abraham, the promise, the covenant that was given to Abraham, might also come to the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. That there was a promise that the Spirit of God would write in the hearts of man God's law rather than on the tablets of stone. That God was going to fill man with his Spirit. And these promises that were made are extended to the Gentile. We see in Acts verse 1:8 that Jesus' disciples weren't to depart from Jerusalem until they received the Holy Spirit. You'll receive the Holy Spirit you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. You'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and to the ends of the earth. That we see that God fulfills his promise in sending the Spirit in Acts chapter to, and that promise is extended to the Gentile in Acts chapter 11 as the Spirit of God was moving in the place of Antioch. You see, as we work through the book of Acts, as we work through the early church, we see that it's through the preaching of the word that the Spirit descends, wherever the word is proclaimed, wherever the word is presented, the Spirit of God surely is to follow. And that is both for the Jew and for the Gentile. You see, through the church, the immeasurable grace of God is displayed in the gathering of the saints, as all people are fellow heirs, as all people through faith in Jesus are members of the body, and all people are partakers through faith in Jesus of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Those who otherwise wouldn't naturally belong together supernaturally have been brought together, knit together by a bond that cannot easily be broken. God uses unlikely people to reveal his glory. He reveals Saul, later to be known as Paul, and he uses the Gentiles to reveal the magnitude of the riches of his grace, as both Jew and Gentile are fellow heirs, are members of the body, and are partakers of the same promise. See, and yet, oftentimes we find what we experience in life is something completely different. Rather than the unity described here in Ephesians chapter 3, we experience disunity. And the questions that I have as I kind of lean into the conclusion of our time together is, have my interests and purposes and values been shaped by God, or are they rooted in myself? You see, because I believe that the subtle affront to my faith in my life is not a full-on assault on taking God out of my life, but elevating self as the ultimate authority. And if I'm the one that's defining my purpose, if I'm the one that's defining my interests and values, then it becomes all about me. But if I'm called to be a part of the body of God where Jesus is the head of the church, then God's the one that gets to shape and reshape and reform my interests, purpose, and values. And that's what leads to the beautiful unity within the church. Second kind of takeaway and question I have I limited the means through which God's glory can be revealed, or have I fixed my gaze upon the God who is sovereign over the means of my life? And I think that's a timely word in our church life, that there are means, there are circumstances that would stand against what we think could allow the gospel and the work of God in our life to carry forward. And I'm telling you, if you could just kind of taste and see and feel what it would have been like to be a first century Christian, the fact that God could use Saul is just pushes us through that struggle. That means don't determine the outcome, but God's sovereign over the means. And so as we fix our gaze upon God, we're confident to press forward in the work of God, regardless of the circumstance or the means that surround us. And then finally, have I stepped into my inheritance in Christ, found within the church, as an heir, as a member of the body, as one who has been given, a partaker of the promises of God? Have I stepped into the inheritance of being a part of the assembly of the saints, or am I walking in isolation from the community that God has ordained me to live my life in? See, I'm convinced that much of the struggle that we have as people is because we live our life in the Western world so disconnected from other people, so autonomous and isolated and independent. And yet God has created us as people to function with some sort of dependence on one another, where I benefit from the companionship of my wife, where I benefit from the companionship of the brotherhood that I find within the church, or the sisterhood that I find within the church. That God's created me like that. And we live in a world that would say, you can't be a part of community. And yet we are committed to community because we're committed to the gospel work that we believe is revealed as the saints assemble, whether that's on Zoom, whether that's each week through YouTube, whether that's in a place that's socially distanced, that we're committed to the visible display of God's wisdom being revealed to the entire world, both earthly and terrestrial and celestial, as God reveals it through local church. I hope this morning you're encouraged to press forward and lean into the work of God, that you're reminded that God uses unlikely people to reveal his glory. You may look in the mirror and you say, I'm not the likely candidate to see the work of God advance in our city. And yet, in God's providence, he placed you in this moment, in this time, in this place, for his purposes. And I'm praying that you walk in the fullness of that. God, we're thankful for your grace in our life. We're thankful for your word that reminds us that you use unlikely people to reveal your glory. Lord, I much like Paul, feel most unlikely to be a part of the work that you've invited us into here in Issaquah on the east side, throughout the Puget Sound, Pacific Northwest, and throughout our nation and around the world. And yet you saw fit, Lord, to plant each of us together in this time, in this place, for your purposes. And so, God, we ask that you would give us great faith to press forward in that work as our eyes are fixed upon you, the God who's sovereign over our circumstances. Lord, may we not fall prey to the subtle assault against not just pushing you out of our lives, but removing you from the position of authority in our life. But rather, Lord, might we fully understand what it means to be heirs of God, that we don't contend for the position of God, but we're heirs of God, that we're members of a body where Christ is the head, and that we are partakers of the promises that are found in Jesus. Lord, we love you, and we thank you for your word and the life that comes through studying it. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Hey, church, I count it a privilege to gather with you each week. Know that you can join us on Sundays live stream at 9:30 or 11. As you saw last week, we still working out some of the quality of what that looks like in our new space. So we're going to continue to provide these teachings unless we can't capture what we're doing on Sunday morning for you on a Sunday, and then we're just going to encourage you to tune into the live stream. But we're going to continue to provide these teachings as long as we need to care for you, to care for your family well. Know that we're praying for you this week. Know that we're here for you. If you need anything, don't hesitate to reach out. My cell is 208-695-0260. My email, wforce2rs@summitlifeseattle.com. Count it a privilege to serve as your pastor, and I'm excited for the things that God has in store for us in this coming season. God bless.